Welcome to the Lovecraft eZine videocast and podcast. This is October the 2nd, 2016. And today's guest is Catherine Grant. Hey, Catherine.
Hello.
Thanks for being on the show. Let's do our quick intros and then talk to Catherine. Let's start with Joe. Work our way over.
How you doing? Joe Pulver, writer, editor.
And Kelly?
I'm Kelly Young, executive editor of Strange Eons magazine.
Matt.
Matt Carpenter, executive editor of Kelly Young.
Pete.
I am Pete Rolick, lord of the editors at over Matt Carpenter.
Rick.
Rick Lay, writer.
That's how you actually get the work done.
I'm trying to think of something cool to top all that, but I'll just say I'm Mike Davis and leave it at that. So anyway, Catherine Grant, thanks for being on. For those watching or listening later who don't know who you are and what you do, can you introduce yourself, talk about yourself for a little bit here?
Sure. I am primarily a short story writer. I've had some short stories published with Shock Totem, with New England Horror Writers. Their latest anthology is coming out at the end of October. It's called Wicked Witches. And that's going to be released at the Salem Open Market Halloween weekend. So that should be, that'll be exciting. I've never been to Salem during Halloween time, so I've heard it's a little crazy, but I'm looking forward to that.
That sounds cool.
It is going to be really cool. Yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to that. So I also have a short story coming out with Grinning Skull Press at their cranial, it's called Cranial Leakage 2, an anthology, and that should be coming out actually any week now. The release date's been pushed off, but it should be coming out either this week or next week. I also have a short story coming out with a new publisher called Time Alone Press. It's called Let Us In, and it's actually going to be 3 volumes. My story's going to be in the 3rd volume, and that's actually not been announced yet. Volumes, and there's roughly about 15 to 20 stories in each volume is a little bit of a project, so mine has not been announced yet, the release date. And I'm also a slush reader for Shock Totem when they were still doing their magazine, and for Lamplight magazine.
Let Us In, that's not a vampire anthology, is it?
The theme is really loose. It was pretty much anything that you would let in, you know, let into your life, or be it, you know, emotionally, or let us in as in, you know, the vampire lore or whatever other. It was very loose, so you could pretty much use any monster you wanted. I chose to do a kind of a little bit different take on that. Mine was about a mother who finds out that her son is a serial killer, and so she kicks him out of the house. He's living kind of like this destitute life in like a studio apartment and trying to scrounge by, and she feels guilty about it, about, you know, having a son that's like this. So invites to live with her from her church that end up treating her very badly. You know, she lets them into her life and they end up not being as great as she thinks they are. And so she calls her son to take care of it for her. And I let my husband's also a writer. I let him beta read everything I write, and that's the only thing he's ever read from me that he said afterwards, you know, that was really fucked up. it's got a lot of great people that are in it reading it and buying it myself, so.
So she was not okay with her son being a serial killer at first, but when she needed something taken care of, then she changed her mind.
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, it's an age old story.
I know.
You know what? I'm sorry. I do this all the time. I forgot to talk about prizes. I'm going to give this away. For those listening later who can't see what I'm holding up, it is a old-timey looking key with a tag on it, leather tag on it, that says Gilman House, Innsmouth, Massachusetts, room 428. So I don't know what that means or what significance that has, but...
Yeah. I'm taking that.
Oh, you are you? Okay. I randomly drew Kelly Young's name. So if we're also going to give away a couple of copies of Nightmare's Disciple, Kindle copies. And we'll probably give away some print copies in future episodes as well. Nightmare's Disciple, Lovecraft eZine Press just reprinted this Lovecraftian Murder Mystery by Joe Pulver. So that's a total of three prizes. And if you want those prizes, if you're a viewer or a listener, as always, you have a week, and I'll tell you how to win those near the end of the show. So, sorry, Catherine, I always forget to do that before I start talking to the guests.
No worries.
And in light of what we're going to talk about, or at least some of what we're going to talk about, I feel I should mention this for anyone listening for the first time. Yet, no, I do not have a policy of an all-male panel. usually we have Salome here and S.P. Miskowski here. S.P.'s on a deadline. She's trying to get a novel finished, but she'll be back in a week or two. And then Salome is just waiting on her new computer because her old computer would no longer handle the Google chat. So I'm hoping Salome will be back next week too. It just depends on how soon her computer that she ordered arrived. So anyway, with all that out of the way, how long have you been writing?
I've been writing for about, I would say, 9 years. I really didn't start in horror. I've always loved horror, you know, since I was a kid. But I began writing some fantasy young adult novel that I worked, and finally I realized that I needed to put it aside and sort of move on. And then I, through a friend, I got involved with New England horror writers and realized that the horror community is pretty awesome. They're really supportive and very, you know, just a really kind of a tribe, a family, mentality and feel. And I really enjoyed that. And, you know, yeah. I just kind of started getting ideas and writing stories down and kind of went from there.
I'm assuming you prefer writing short stories, or are you also working on any novels? I think in our video test you said that you were working on a novel as well. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yes. I did finish the fantasy young adult novel a while ago and put it aside. It did have a complete manuscript, but the novel that I learned to write on and probably should stay in the trunk, at least for now. And then I started and stopped. I feel like this happens to a lot of people I've talked to, you know, when they finish that first novel and they move on to a second, is they start and stop. So I started and stopped 7 times. So I had like 7 half, you know, finished manuscripts. And then I don't know if all of you know James Moore, but he found, I basically told on myself that I had all these half-finished manuscripts and, you know, yelled at me and said, you need to cut the shit and just sit down and finish something. So last fall I started again on a manuscript I had. I call it a feminist horror novel because it's not intentionally, I think, found a lot of feminist themes, but it's about a woman who is a video game designer, and she is fired from her job. Energy is being focused on her.
I'm sorry. Could you say that last part again? You froze up a little bit.
Sure.
Your computer's mad at Google Hangout.
Maybe. So she is fired from her job as a video game designer and targeted by gamer gators. And she's kind of forcefully recruited by a coven of witches who want to use, you know, the energy being focused on her, you know, the emotional energy. So I am working on that right now. I'm about 70,000 words in, so I've been making pretty decent progress on it. And but I find short stories come really easy, a little bit easier to me than writing novels. I think I've been struggling to find the stamina to write a novel.
Yeah.
And whereas short stories, if I get a good idea, I can generally run with it and have it finished like in a couple days.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and I do know James Moore, and he was on the show about a month or so ago. He's a really great guy, great writer, and sounds like he kicked you in the butt and told you to get moving on some stuff. Still there?
Yeah. Can you just repeat that last question?
Oh, you know what I'm going to do? Not that we mind seeing you, but I'm going to turn off your video. You can still hear me, right? You still there?
Still here.
Okay. Because most people listen to this audio podcast anyway, and it sounds like your computer's not handling both the video and the audio. That happens sometimes. So,
okay.
No, I just said James Moore is a nice guy. I said he sounded like he kind of kicked you and got you moving on some of your writing. So,
yeah, in the absolute nicest way possible.
Well, he is a nice guy.
Yes, absolutely.
What drew you to horror in the first place? You know, reading it as well as, well, you talked about writing a little bit, but what drew you to horror in the first place? Or what do you like about horror, maybe, is a better question.
I think I've always just liked, I mean, since I was a kid, I mean, I remember when I was 11, my father bought me a Edgar Allan Poe collection. And, you know, I was really little, and some of it I didn't obviously understand, but I was always drawn to, I think, the emotional aspect of horror. I think that's something that you know, people who aren't fans don't generally think of horror as being highly emotional, but it absolutely is. And I liked how it affected me more so than like the Babysitter's Club, obviously. It just, it appeals to me emotionally much more than traditional, you know, children's books did.
Yeah. All right. So you came to my attention. I knew I'd seen your name around, but you know, there's so many people in the tribe, as you put it, that, and we don't all know each other. But you came to my attention a couple of months ago when you wrote a post about diversity in horror and in weird fiction genre, and I've got it in front of me. And, you know, of course, I contacted you and asked if you'd come on the show and talk about it some from your perspective. I linked to it on the website and on the YouTube page. And I'll just read the very beginning of it. Women in Horror Month was quiet this year. It took until March for social media to explode with controversy involving women and people of color in horror. This time about a popular anthology and the distinct lack of diversity in the table of contents. Adding fuel to the fire was the anthology editor's Facebook comments that ranged from unprofessional to downright rude. And I'll stop there for now. And then, and again, let me apologize for Google Hangout is so moody. So let me apologize for turning off your video, but I think your computer will handle it a lot better. You know, obviously you didn't name any names in the post, and we don't need to do that here either, but can you talk a little bit about what happened and why you wrote the blog post after it happened?
Yeah. I mean, basically, I had seen, you know, a lot of the Facebook comments and sort of the social media explosion that happened, you know, regarding the table of contents when it came out, both from other people and from the editor as well. And I mean, his explanation was that, you know, he only looks at the quality of the stories. He doesn't look at the gender. He doesn't look at, you know, the name at all. And
right.
I mean, honestly, because our community is small, yeah, I don't think it takes much to look at a table of contents and, you know who you know, and you know that, you know, it isn't just a coincidence that, you know, most of the people that are on the table of contents, you know, are either friends or, you know, either people that are affiliated with this person in some way, and that not only is this person maybe being a little bit dishonest about, you know, the writing is all I look at, but there might be, you know, some discrimination and nepotism involved. And, you know, I think when stuff like this happens, it puts, you know, it put me in a really difficult position. And I know that I had other people that messaged me that felt the same way, where, you know, you don't want to be supportive of someone who's not encouraging diversity, but at the same time, you want to support your friends who might be in this anthology and might be excited about it.
That's a good point. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's really, I kept it anonymous for that. Like, I didn't really mention any names for that reason, because, you know, I do have friends that are in this anthology that, you know, I don't think necessarily don't deserve it, but I don't want them to feel bad. I mean, it's not their fault, obviously, that there's not the lack of diversity in this anthology.
Right.
And, you know, as a slush reader myself, I wanted to kind of call shenanigans on that, because I've seen how diverse slush piles are, you know, with Shock Totem, and now with, you know, I started doing Lamplight just this month, so it doesn't really apply to that, but Lamplight also has an extremely diverse, you know, slush pile. And so I just started writing, and I had written before about the difficulties of being a woman in publishing, and, you know, I think I have kind of a unique perspective on that, because, you know, not only am I a woman in publishing, a woman, you know, in horror, but I have a husband who's also in that same position. So I see the differences between the way people treat me and the way people treat him, you know, when we're in the same exact room.
Yeah, you know, excuse me. I don't want to interrupt. Can I ask two quick questions there? Because
sure.
If I don't do it now, I will forget. And my first question is, on this particular anthology, was it invite only, or was it a open kind of slush fund, everyone can submit type thing? And then after you answer that, I was wondering if you would elaborate a bit on, because I think this is a very interesting point, and it'll really highlight some things that you're talking about, is, you know, how your husband and you are treated differently.
Yeah, you know? Absolutely. It was an open call anthology. So yeah. It was, and it had a very long, you know, submission period. So in my opinion, there really wasn't an excuse for the lack of diversity, because the submission period was so long. And as far as, you know, the ways, I mentioned a couple things in the article about the way, you know, my husband and I are treated differently. But I think the biggest one is just, and I don't think it's even intentional, but I've been in social situations, either at conventions or, you know, just, you know, events where, I mean, most people know that we're both writers, but he will get engaged about what he's doing with his writing or what, you know, what he's being submitted to, and I'll kind of not get that same treatment, you know, and I definitely, I mean, there's definitely people that do, like, the biggest one that I can think of is John Langan. I mean, I see John Langan, and he asks me and Barry both the same. I mean, hey, what are you writing? What's going on with your writing? And I really appreciate that from him. I told him that, you know, that I really appreciate that he treats us both me and my husband as equals when he sees us. There's no differentiation, you know, in how we're treated with him.
Yeah. And he is a hell of a guy.
Yes. I love John Lane. He's a great guy. And he's always asking me what I'm doing with my writing and, you know, and telling me how happy he is if I'm submitting something. So I appreciate him a lot.
But what you're saying is that he's in many ways the exception to that. Yeah, that a lot of people don't. They'll ask that of your husband, but not of you per se.
Yeah. And like I said, I don't think it's intentional. I mean, I think there's always a danger of pointing something like that out because it seems so self-serving, mm-hmm. you know, in the moment. It's really hard to point out stuff like this sometimes because it does seem kind of awkward and self-serving, like, hey, you know, like, pay attention to me. But, you know, so I don't mention it, but and I don't think it's intentional, but it is kind of like kind of a subconscious bias that I think kind of really hurts, you know, women authors socially, unfortunately.
You know, I'm reminded of the presidential debate 6 days ago. I'm not going to quote this exactly right, but what you said just now when Hillary was asked about, I think the question was, does she think that cops are racially biased? And she had a really good answer that something along the lines of that we all have to battle perhaps this innate subconscious bias and fight against that, you know, sexism, racism, and so forth. You know?
Yeah, absolutely. I absolutely
and to make sure that we're not doing those things.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. Completely. And you know, the thing is when I was writing up notes, you know, for the podcast, and I did keep on thinking about Hillary and about the debate, and it kept coming to mind as example. You know, and I don't want to get political and talk about the election, because I think, you know, I'm personally tired of talking about it, and I'd rather not get political,
you know, yeah, in that way.
Yes. But I mean.
But I did think it was a good answer, though. You know, it's just we're all human, and you know, we have to fight against these things. You know, and some people aren't fighting against it.
Yeah.
So. Okay. So, what did anything end up happening with this? He was. I think you said in the blog post that he was justifying it in several ways, basically saying that he didn't look at, you know, gender or race or anything like that. But then it sounds like it was a list of all or nearly all white males. Does that sound about right?
It was overwhelmingly, you know, white men that were in, you know, that were in the TOC. And someone did call him out on it on Facebook and had said, you know, why aren't there more women in the TOC? And he got quite rude about it and, you know, and did defend himself and, you know, said, you know, I get tired of hearing this line. I think that a lot of people do, you know, it doesn't matter if you're black or white or green or purple. You know, I don't know where these green and purple people are, but I bet you they're tired of being used in this excuse over and over.
Lauren from Angel, you know, the green demon, that's probably who they're talking about. So
yeah, precisely. You know, it's like that really only holds weight if, like you and I had talked about it on, you know, on the sound test that mm-hmm. you had been trying to get women to, you know, to get on the, you know, involved in the podcast and that you hadn't really had any luck. And, you know, I absolutely acknowledge that there are, you know, maybe like niche genres where it might be really hard to get a table of contents that has a lot of diversity. But this was not the case. It was more of a mainstream, you know, anthology where I'm sure they got quite a few submissions. I mean, it was a pro-rate anthology. So I don't see, I mean, myself, knowing what's out there in the slush, I just don't see how that's possible. And I think that was my primary goal with the blog post, was to kind of say, you know, this is not an acceptable answer and not an acceptable excuse anymore for lack of diversity.
Without knowing what this anthology was it, do you guess that a lot of people knew about it when it was announced that we're looking for submissions? I mean, things are announced and sometimes you just don't see them. You know, there's not much noise made about the fact that, you know, Beer Bottle Cthulhu is looking for submissions or whatever. Was this something that when it was announced, there was any, you know, what was it announced in places where a lot of people were going to see it and have the opportunity? Just because it's announced and anybody can submit, that doesn't mean, I'm trying to get a sense of what the size of this book was as far as who might have known about it or, you know.
Yeah, that's a good question. What's your thoughts on that, Catherine?
It was a pretty big deal. I mean, it's definitely possible that people might not have seen the submission call. To be honest, the submission call was made a long time before it was actually published. And I'm sorry for being so vague. I know this is probably incredibly frustrating, but
No.
You know, and nothing to apologize for.
I'm one of those who's very guilty of, you know, I don't care if you're purple or green or what your plumbing is as an editor. I've said that repeatedly. Only you can pick up books that I'm that say Joe Pulver editor and look at the table of contents. I walk the walk, you know, so
yeah.
I don't think it's hard to get a table of contents that turns heads as far as diversity at all. Because I read, and there is a plethora of talent who are women nowadays. Easily half of my favorite writers are women. Some of my favorite writers are LGBT, you know, or people of color. Some editors don't read, not widely. So I'm just trying to get a sense of, you know, if you go back and look at Lovecraft eZine since its inception, you know, you're going to find women listed on the table of contents. Mike has always been open to, you know, pick up a Ross Lockhart edited anthology or one by Ellen or Strange Eons as a magazine. I can list a number of places that are diverse.
Hang on a second. Listen, I really take issue with the constant people trying to promote Strange Eons on this show. It happened last night. It's happening again. Oh. And, you know, Kelly. Yeah. Young,
I got to admit, I'm a little tired of it myself. Strange Eons issue 20 on sale now.
Yeah. Okay. But, you know,
Catherine's like, what did I get myself into with these?
No, I'm
not picking on anybody.
I think
this is a great theme. I just think there's X amount of editors out there, I agree. There are X amount of editors out there who haven't read widely, or their circle of friends, if that's what it is. Sometimes that is. I think other times it's writing acquaintances. You mentioned you belong to the New England Horror Writers something, Catherine?
Yes. Yep, the New England Horror Writers.
So those are people you are close to by association.
Yes.
To some degree, would lean on them because you know them. They're easy to communicate with. In some way, shape, or form, they're your friends.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's nothing wrong with that. I mean, that's part of one of the great things in this community is your abilities, not you in particular, but our abilities to be able to network. To develop new relationships. But I think there are X number of editors out there who have never expanded out of their particular little sandbox rather than looking to, widen the borders.
Catherine, I have a question for you. And I'll preface it by saying I was talking to a friend a few months ago who was going through, and I said to him, you know, one of the things I hate, I've got experience with that, a lot of experience. One of the things I hate is when you're going through something, whether it's an illness or anything, and people say, yeah, I know how you feel, when they really don't, you know, or they'll give advice and they're not in that situation and they can't possibly know how you feel. So with that in mind, you know, I'm a white male, and so many editors are. What can we do? Let's say you got a guy out there who's an editor, who's a publisher. He sincerely wants diversity. What steps does he need to take to make sure that it's happening from your standpoint? You know, not what I think, but what you think that we should be doing, that they should be doing.
Well, I know that you've had Mercedes Yardley on the show. We talked about this during the sound test, and she's talked about, you know, reading blind. And I think, you know, that's a great tool, but I feel like, you know, from talking to writers who are women, who are part of the LGBT community, who are people of color, I mean, like we had talked about, it's harder to know if an author is, you know, a minority or, you know, part of the LGBT community, just from a name, it's pretty impossible. But I feel like, you know, because of social situations and certain other, you know, cultural, you know, differences, I feel like a lot of those people feel really isolated from the community. You know, and this is something that, you know, I tell people, you know, just because your experience is positive doesn't mean everybody's experience is positive in a community. And I think if you really want a great table of contents that has, you know, diversity, my suggestion would be to reach out to people, you know, read widely, you know, read like Joe said, read widely. And then, you know, if you find a great author who you would love to see in your table of contents, reach out to them and ask them if they'd be interested in submitting, and then read blind, you know, like don't just take a story because it's from someone who's diverse, you know, reach out and ask them for something. And if it's a great story, then take it, you know, like then I feel like those two steps, you know, reaching out to people and then reading blind to make sure you're getting the best stories possible and you're staying true to your readers. I think that's the best approach.
My wife and I were talking too, and when I ask these questions, they're not leading. In other words, I'm not saying, okay, here's what I think, and I'm trying to nudge you that. Sorry, you still there? I think we froze for a second. The whole point of conversations like this is to get different viewpoints. You know, and if we disagree, not me and you, but if people disagree, then find out why we disagree and what we can learn from each other.
Exactly.
My wife and I were talking, or have had this conversation, you know, very generally speaking, because, you know, there's women who like things that men don't and vice versa. But what we were trying to figure out is, you know, is it true that in general, more women like a certain genre than others? Do more women, for example, like romance? Do more men like horror? I'm not saying that is the case. I would like your thoughts on it. You know, as far as readers, viewers of movies, whatever, consumers of fiction in whatever form. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, I don't know the statistics and the numbers on that. All I can tell you is how I feel.
Yeah, me either. Like I said, it's not a leading question.
and I definitely feel that, you know, obviously certain things appeal more to one genre than the other, and that those are generalizations that we can't always, you know, say are true. I mean, I have a lot of female friends who love horror, and I don't know if that's necessarily because I'm into it, and so I gravitate towards people who are. But I feel like I have quite a few female friends who enjoy what I write and want to read what I write, and I mean, my best friend, we've been friends since we were 11, and one of the things that brought us together was we read Stephen King. We did an audio tape together of The Raft when we were 12. I don't know where that tape went, but...
Oh, that's cool.
If it ever resurfaces, you know, if I ever, you know, become big someday, she'll probably make sure it resurfaces.
During your presidential campaign.
But, so I feel like a lot of women are interested in horror. Romance, I think if there wasn't such a stigma about romance, you know, that it's not manly, you know, maybe it would be more acceptable for men to enjoy it. And that's kind of how I feel about that. I mean, my husband really doesn't care about those types of stereotypes. So if a romance was good, he'd probably read it. He probably wouldn't care. But I think others might feel, you know, if they were seen on the subway, you know, with a romance novel, they might get, you know, made fun of. I don't know.
I think it's very, very apparent and obvious that a hell of a lot of women love horror and love weird fiction. You know, and I don't doubt that for a second. I don't really have a thought one way or the other. I'm always curious, though, if it is a 50-50 with everything, you know, science fiction, romance, or if, you know, we innately gravitate as a gender one towards the other, very, very generally speaking, you know, or if that's all a result of, you know, societal conditioning, you know, who knows? So
I think it's probably a little bit of both. I mean, I do believe men and women are different, you know, biologically, you know, in the way our brains work. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't deny that, but I also think it is some, you know, societal conditioning, you know, like I saw a video today of, you know, a little girl who was in a clothing store, and, you know, her mom was asking her how she felt about the girl's clothes versus the boy's clothes. And, you know, the girl's t-shirts says, "Hey," and it's all colorful and pink and just says, "Hey," with like an exclamation point. And then the boy's t-shirt says, you know, "Think outside the box." And, you know, she was English too, so she had this cute accent. She was like, you know, "What does this even mean, hey? I don't even know what this means." But, you know, the boy's one, you know, it says, "Think outside the box, be adventurous, you know. Like, why can't I have that? Why do I have to have hey?" Or the other shirt said beautiful, you know, she said girls are supposed to be beautiful and boys are supposed to be adventurous. And that doesn't make sense to me because, you know, from the mouth of babes, you know, this doesn't make sense to me because I want to be adventurous too. So right. I think it's a little bit of both. I think society is definitely changing in that respect. You know, people are really, you know, evaluating, you know, how we treat genders differently and how maybe we should reevaluate that, and I think that's great. It's progress.
What do you think the differences are, or how are the challenges different, I should say, as an editor? You're an editor as well, reading slush piles and so forth. How are the challenges different, an open call anthology or magazine issue as opposed to an invitation only? And what's your advice on how we need to approach those, each of those differently? Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I've never been involved with an invitation-only anthology. I've only, you know, with Shock Totem and Lamplight, it's been open submission. And both of them, I mean, are kind of like a more general horror, dark fiction. So we received a ton of slush. Shock Totem specifically, when I was working for them, they were, you know, highlighted on Writer's Digest as, you know, one of the best fiction markets. So the slush was pretty epic. And I did try as hard as possible, like, not to pay attention to the names, you know, not to pay attention to the names, not to pay attention to the gender, and to just read for the story. Mm-hmm. And I haven't really experienced with either one really having to search out diversity, especially with Lamplight. That's one of the first things I noticed that I said to Jacob Haddon, who edits Lamplight. I said, there's a lot of international submissions. It was something that was surprising to me. And he said, yeah, you know, next magazine, we're publishing someone from Nigeria who had a really awesome story that they sent in.
That brings up an interesting point. Do you think it's easier on an open submission to have a wide variety, a wide diversity of people submitting because so many people know about that anthology or magazine as opposed to something smaller? Do you think it's harder for the smaller one? It seems like to me it may be that they have to make more of an effort. But what are your thoughts on that?
For like a smaller and unknown magazine, you mean?
Yeah, I mean, you said with Shock Totem, right? It was Shock Totem. Correct. That was getting a lot. It was highlighted, and it was getting international submissions and so forth. It seems like it might be easier to be more diverse as opposed to a smaller one that not as many people know about it, and so therefore not as many people are submitting. But I'm asking the question. I don't pretend to have the answers.
I mean, I know with the Time Alone Press anthology that I mentioned to you, this is not something that I was involved with. I just got a story accepted. But Carl Hexen Sumner, who's the editor of Time Alone Press, it's a brand new press. I mean, this is the first anthology they've ever put out. But he's doing prorates and plus royalties, so obviously the word got around.
Right.
because he's offering good money. Right. And he had about, I think it was between 1,200 and 1,500. I'm not sure the exact amount because he did get some that were emailed to him as well as sent through Submittable. So, I mean, that's a pretty decent amount of submissions. And
wow, 1,500 submissions? That is a lot. Wow.
And he told me that he had read Blind, and one of the things I noticed immediately when he was announcing the table of contents was that it had a women to men ratio of about 70-30, like 70% to 30%, which was really awesome in my opinion.
70% women, 30% men.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. And it was encouraging to me, and I told, you know, and I messaged him and I said, you know, I just want to tell you how encouraging it is to see so many women getting published in this anthology. And he told me it was not intentional. He read Blind and just, you know, and once he picked the ones that he liked, he did whittle it down from there. But you know, and that was not Blind, but yeah, I mean, that's obviously a small press that just started out and is able to get an overwhelming response. And part of that was that he was offering prorates, but the other part was that he really, you know, put it out there on Facebook, really advertised the open submission. It was shared a lot between people I know. I know I shared it on my Facebook page because I felt it was a good opportunity. And I know it's not economically feasible for smaller magazines to get funding like that to give people prorates, but I think that helps.
Oh, sure. Yeah. What do you think is going through the mind, or is it just, you think it's just totally subconscious when we end up with, you know, open submission anthologies or magazines where it's constantly all white males? What's going through that editor's mind? Why is he making these kinds of choices? I mean, maybe, I guess I'm just naive. I can't believe anyone is so sexist in this day and age, but obviously they are, you know? But they can't honestly believe that, okay, these are the best stories. There were just absolutely no women. Out of all these women who submitted to me, there were just very, very little women submissions that were great enough to make the cut, you know?
I mean, one of the things I did say in the blog post is, you know, I don't like to assume that anyone's biased. I always like to try to believe the best thing about people, you know, until they prove otherwise, you know, absolutely. But I mean, I think it depends on the editor. I mean, I think that we live in a world where, yeah, absolutely, you know, discrimination exists, but I also feel like there is a propensity to kind of accuse people of things that they might not necessarily be guilty of. I mean, like I said, if something is like a really niche type thing, like splatterpunk, I mean, I don't think there's a ton of women doing splatterpunk, you know, that type of genre. Mm-hmm. So to have a, you know, something like that that's so specific, it might not necessarily appeal to women as much. And you have, you know, you don't have a lot of women to choose from, or not as many women submit that you would have liked. So you end up with a very, you know, mostly male TOC. Obviously, in that case, it's not going to be intentional. So I think it should be weighed on a case-to-case basis. But, you know, I definitely think there are editors out there who are, you know, who routinely, time and time again, put out table of contents that have mostly, you know, men. Or if they have women, it's someone that they know that's close to them, and, you know, there's nepotism, that, you know, obvious nepotism there. And yeah. And they're not doing the community any favors. They're not doing their readers any favors. You know, I think stuff like that, you know, discrimination and nepotism that's tied into that, it creates, yeah,
obviously, stagnation. I'm not sexist because I published my wife or my friend's wife or something like that.
Yeah, or my friend that I've known for years that I wanted to give a break, or
right,
you know, whatever, you know. And I mean, I don't think that doesn't do the community any favors. It creates stagnation. It to publish the same people over and over and over, it creates stagnation, and it creates, you know, it doesn't help people out that maybe deserve it. There are lots of wonderful writers out there who might not be getting a break because you're publishing, you know, your wife or your friend instead of them.
Right. Pete's mentioned that several times on this show, you know, a couple editors, and, you know, not by name, but it's the same people over and over. Yeah. So,
well, it's not, I know that we've looked at this in a couple different ways. I've looked at a couple anthologies and realized that the average age of the person in the anthology is over 60. You know, these are people who go to the stable of writers that they have gone to for the last 25 years, and it hasn't changed. I find that problematic. It just doesn't work for me. There are plenty of talented young writers. There are plenty of talented women writers. There are plenty of talented LGBT writers. If you want to put together a decent anthology, why do you keep going back to the same people? It's relatively easy. The answer to that is easy. It's because they deliver, and, you know, they're your friends, and they've delivered in the past. But as Catherine has said, the genre at all doesn't do readers any favors.
Nope. And you're over 60, and so, and you're not getting in on that, right? I'm sorry, Pete. Yeah.
Thanks. So, a whole hell of.
I'm sorry, Pete. I'll plug your book later. How's that?
My little heart goes pitter-patter.
Completely forgot what I was going to ask next. Yeah, and there's absolutely no excuse for it in at all in invite onlys, you know?
No, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, and I can't think of any examples right now of, you know, of editors that have, you know, well, I can, but I won't, you know, like I said, I don't want to name any names, but, you know, there's, to be positive, there's lots of editors, like Joe said, there's lots of editors out there that are trying as hard as possible to be inclusive and to encourage women, you know, like I said, like John Langan, that he's always asking me, you know, how my writing's going, just like my husband, you know, or people like Christopher Golden, you know, who he calls himself a big hairy feminist. And he's always encouraging, you know, encouraging women writers to get out there and do things and recognizing that there is bias. And I think that that's the biggest thing that I feel like women really want in general, is to just have our experiences acknowledged and have people listen to us. And, you know, we want to be able to call out discrimination without being afraid of being invalidated, you know, by people in our community.
Yeah, because that's the other thing. That's actually what when I lost my train of thought, that's what I was going to say, is that that's problematic too when you called this guy on it, or I've seen it, you know, more than once. They get upset about it, you know, like they get very defensive.
Yes, I mean, he had not read my blog post, but, other people had mentioned it to him, and I got a message from him on Facebook. Okay. And, I woke up one morning to a message from Facebook, and, you know, people who know me will tell you, like, I'm not afraid of confrontation. It does not, you know, intimidate me at all. So, he asked, you know, what's your problem, basically? And I asked him, I said, well, did you read my blog post? And he said, no, so I sent him the link.
Well, if you read my blog post, then you know what my problem is.
Yeah, I said, here, and you know, and he just told me that he felt that it suffered from cultural Marxism, which is just... Cultural Marxism is just another word for, it's just another way to call me a social justice warrior.
Oh, okay.
Just a fancier way to say, to say social justice warrior. And, you know, obviously, since I've been doing a novel about Gamergate, I've been, you know, researching a lot about social justice warriors and that term. And although, you know, we're not gamers, obviously, I feel like horror and you know, science fiction and fantasy, you know, we share geek culture a little bit. And, you know, I think we have some similar issues, you know, where culture is changing. And, you know, there's kind of these dinosaurs thrashing in the tar pit, making a lot of noise, you know, not wanting to change, you know, with the time. You know, fear of losing social currency, you know, fear of losing relevancy, you know, or guilt. You know, I think that that's one thing that Christopher Golden has talked about on his podcast, is, you know, with the Pixel Project, which is, you know, it's a fundraiser for, you know, to eliminate violence against women. And, you know, he talked about how, you know, men feel guilty either about their own attitudes or their own actions in the past, you know, towards women. And I think that some men, you know, say, how can I change this? How can I, you know, make myself better? How can I make the world better? But, you know, I think guilt, you know, instead of feeling guilty and instead of changing, which is a little bit more difficult, I think the easier reaction sometimes is to just get angry and to just lash back and, and to feel, you know, and not want to deal with those emotions. So, you know, to be honest, like, I don't know what to do with those types of people other than just ask them to have a conversation and, you know, tell me, you know, why they feel a certain way and to just, you know, talk about it and try to work through that, you know, like you mentioned before. But yeah, I feel like the biggest thing that women want, you know, through all these, you know, the women in horror and, you know, all these talks about diversity is that we just want to have our experiences acknowledged and have people listen and, you know, create dialogue in the community to, you know, promote change.
Well, and that's what I want to do too. And that's why I wanted to have you on the show. You know, I really like, I'm looking at your blog post again right now. And one of the things you wrote was, nobody stands up in the middle of a crowded room and announces that they're a misogynist. Exclusion is built not on large acts of violence, but on small gestures that culminate over time into women being marginalized while men are celebrated as being, quote, the best. Certain authors and editors shrug in response and say, what do you want me to do? Like they're powerless to stop it. And then you write, be better, that's what. And then you, you know, go on with some suggestions like getting out of your comfort zone and seeking out new faces at conventions and so forth. And not treating every woman you go up to like they're a potential date for another.
Yeah, and then to be honest with you, that line specifically resonated with a response from a lot of women about that, you know, because, you know, unfortunately women are judged, I think a lot more so than men on how they look, you know, how they dress. And a very attractive woman, you know, who is just going to try to, you know, to network and to, you know, to meet people for, you know, for professional, she doesn't want to be thought of as part of your dating pool. She wants to be thought of as a person, as a fellow professional. And I think that's one of those cultural, social issues that is worth talking about, but really difficult to handle in the moment.
Yeah. You know,
I definitely think it deserves some dialogue. But yes, I got a lot of comments about that line specifically, to be honest with you.
I'm sorry that it's that way, you know, and hopefully we can work to change this. And there are a lot of good people like John Langan, a lot of good men like John Langan and Christopher Golden, you know, Jim Moore, who are that way. And then there are a lot who need to change, you know, and it doesn't mean nobody's all bad or all good. If this is something you're an editor and this is something you need to work on, it doesn't mean that you are now officially classified as an evil person, but it's like you said, try to do better, you know?
Yeah, so. Absolutely. Try to do just, you know, in the slush pile, but there is a really distinct social handicap that women have, you know, in publishing. You know, when you go into a room, you know, full of men at a convention, and like I said, like I feel this more so because I feel like, you know, having a husband that's a writer who goes with me to all these events, you know, I see how we're both treated differently. And right. I seem to have the exact opposite problem that a lot of the women that message me, where, you know, I'm married, obviously, so I'm dating pool for everybody, you know, but my husband. But I mean, I know you, especially now, because you turned my video is turned off, but tall woman, I am 6'1". You know, with heels on, I'm about 6'5". So, unfortunately, that has been an issue my whole life, that it is very intimidating to men. And this is something that I've written about, you know, in the past, that, you know, I call it the invisible woman. And when when you're not considered attractive to someone as a woman, sometimes you become invisible, invisible socially, mm-hmm. And that doesn't really matter to me in any other situation besides professionally, as a writer. When I come into a room, I want to be seen as a friend and as a professional, and I want to be judged based on my writing talent. I don't want to be judged based on how attractive you find me. I don't want to be judged based on what I'm wearing. And I don't hear from men that they face that issue very often. I don't know. I mean, you would tell me that, could answer that better than I could.
They don't. We don't. Yeah. You're right.
Yeah. I mean, when you go to a convention, do you worry about what you wear?
I wear a ratty t-shirt and jeans and tennis shoes. And so, no, I don't at all.
Actually, I've repacked my suitcase for this Thursday 4 times. So,
well, there are exceptions. Yes. Yes, I grant you.
But the issue I have...
There are exceptions, but...
Sorry, go ahead, Catherine. Sorry.
There definitely are exceptions, but I think that, I mean, one goal of mine is for our society to change enough where, that's not going to be an issue. I'm not going to get judged based on my looks or based on what I'm wearing or, based on my interests. I read an article a long, long, long time ago. I don't remember the context of it, but it was talking about, things women should do in business, to get ahead. And one of the things it said was, you need to learn how to play golf. And I mean, what the heck, obviously, what the heck does that have to do?
Yeah.
I mean, it's got nothing to do really with business, but social situation, maybe have an edge over someone who doesn't play golf, but obviously that's a very, a very male interest, I think that unfortunately publishing being very, very male centric, there's a lot of things that are kind of like that in publishing and horror, let's all go to the bar and get some expensive scotch, whereas I personally don't like scotch, and I know there are women who do, but, and I'm not knocking anyone who does like scotch, but, it's because I'm not interested in that as a woman, I might feel excluded, I might not be included in a conversation that could be really important to my career, and,
Can I chime in here for a second?
Absolutely.
Tons of people go to the bar, and yes, there's a lot of drinking, but just because most people are drinking, I'm a diabetic, I'm not supposed to drink, and I don't go to heart, I go to like one convention a year, if that many. So yes, when I get with a couple of particular buddies, I'll have a expensive scotch, but just as often I'm having a soda or hot tea. Liquor is not the only thing served in a bar. And like, if you look at Ellen's like, well, I'm going to Killer Con. So if you don't get this, here's my schedule. And if you're looking for me other than that, I'll be in the bar. It doesn't mean Ellen's a lush, but it's like the bar is a good place to hang out. There's less restrictions. You can take over a corner and people can come and people can go, and you don't have to sit down and pay for a $25 meal to congregate. It's not all alcohol soaked, because of the amount of passion going around. I mean, about the work. What are you up to? Oh, Joe, you're doing that. Mike, you're going to do that. Wow, that's really cool. Oh, and such and such is. you know, so you're getting to interact and network. You're getting to become deeper involved with people that you like, people that you admire their work. I just think, you know, it's one of those things where a lot goes on and at a convention in the bar.
You know, we had that floating table at H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival 2 years ago.
Yeah.
For like 12 hours.
Last Necronomicon, there was one night, Damien, Jeff Thomas, oh my God, the amount of people coming and going, Griffins, we sat in the one corner by the window, by the front door of whatever the Biltmore Bar is called. I can never remember the name. I mean, we were there 4.5-5 hours. People coming, people going, people having 2 drinks, you know, people just stopping for 5 minutes and chatting before they wandered, you know, back. I mean, they walked by, they saw us, they on the street, they saw us in the window. They ran in, they talked for a few minutes.
But what you're saying, it doesn't matter necessarily if you drink or not. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, you don't have to. And even if you only have 5 minutes, if you're in a hurry, just stop in and say, hey, how you doing? And whatever. It's the, you know, the bar at a convention. And of course, I think it depends on the convention too. And we certainly in the community have, I'll say, lesser elements that I certainly don't want to deal with. I would prefer they stay home, but they don't seem to. But
you said you wanted to be on the podcast.
Yeah. But there are, this community is filled with a lot of really wonderful, generous, open people who are concerned with inclusion. And inclusion, it means inclusion. I don't care if you're 6'5". I don't care if you're 2'3". And yep, I am guilty of green or candy cane stripe Martian too. Are you nice? You got any talent? That's what I care about. I as an editor, I'm looking to expand my horizons, because way before I was an editor and way before I was a writer, I was a reader. And there is nothing more thrilling to me than to be editing an anthology, and I've invited someone, and I'm the first one to get to read what they wrote, and it's mind-blowing. It's like being the guy who's lucky enough to drive the taxi to the hospital so somebody can have a baby. It's like you're the godfather. If it wasn't for your invitation, this might not have been written. And when you get something that's really, really great, that's thrilling. I mean, I get off on that. It's like being 16 and you come over to my house and I go, Catherine, you got to hear this new record. Wow, this is really great. You know, that's what this is about to me. And I think there's a whole bunch of people that that's what this is about. I'm just saddened that we have that other element in the pond that for whatever reason don't get it.
Unfortunately the experience, you know, and I know this from talking to people who've, you know, been in a con situation, where they've had an experience with one of those people, and sometimes that's all it takes to discourage them from wanting to be involved in the community. And
those people I want to take out in back of the barn and beat to death for ruining it for other people, because there are those of us who are at conventions,
yeah,
who we may be busier than hell and not have much time to spend with you, but we can be quite generous. You know, but it's also up to you, to the other person, to know, Are they busy? Can I walk over and say hi? Do I insert myself in the middle of this conversation? Do I wait a minute? You know, how you present yourself. But we're there. Yes, we're there to promote our work. We're there to hang out with our friends. But we're also there to meet new people. We're there. We're there as professionals to find new talent. So
what were you gonna say, Catherine?
I think that as writers, I mean, there's always a certain amount of kind of social awkwardness. I mean, we're an awkward bunch of people. I mean, there's always, you know, that, you know, how to approach someone and that uncertainty about, you know, if someone is open to talking to you or if they're going to be nice to you. I mean, one of the things I did kind of in preparation for this podcast a while ago was I kind of pulled my whole Facebook list, took friends with a lot of authors.
You pulled who?
I pulled my Facebook friends list, and I pulled the women first. I say, you know, women friends of mine, you know, what is the worst thing that's ever been said to you in a professional environment as a writer? And then I asked the men after that, and I mean, overwhelmingly, the comments that the women got were, you know, you're a woman, so you can't be a real horror writer. You know, it was specifically aimed at their gender. You know, and, you know, like even Damien Angelica Walters was one of the ones who commented, and she said that she had been told that she was too pretty to be a horror writer, and asked, you know, does your husband allow you to have this hobby? Like, ridiculous stuff. And, you know.
This is the 21st century, right? Does your husband allow you to have this hobby? And it's not a career, right? It's a hobby.
Yeah, I know. Or, you know, or when my friend Amber Fallon, she was told by someone at I believe a convention that she didn't write paranormal romance. And, you know, I've read her stuff, and her stuff is definitely not paranormal romance. And there, you know, then I pulled, you know, the men, you know, what was the worst thing that you've ever had said over, you know, commonly or bad reviews. And some of them flat out said, you know, I've been thinking about this since you asked your, you know, women friends, you know, the same question, and I can't think of anything that's as bad as what they said they'd been, you know, been had said to their face.
You broke up for a second, but what you said was that you pulled the men after the women, and that was the men's response.
That was the response I got from quite a few people, and then, you know, for the most part, it was genre snobbery and, you know, and, you know, bad reviews that they said that was the worst thing that they've ever had said to them. I mean, obviously for, you know, people like, you know, for Damien, and people like Damien and Angelica Walters, I mean, obviously she doesn't care. I mean, I think she's going to be even more incredibly successful than she already is. Her writing is amazing.
Yeah.
But there has to be into, and this, I was surprised, but nobody even went into, like, sexual harassment.
I think your computer's, starting to tell us.
But, I mean, obviously, that's kind of a really personal.
You broke up again. I think your computer's trying to tell us that it's had enough of Google Hangout for the day. I don't know. Google Hangout's so moody sometimes. Before I let you go, is there anything that I should have asked that, or that you want to talk about for you, or anything that I didn't cover? Or did we cover it?
I think we pretty much covered it. Most of the notes that I had. But yeah, thank you for having me, and thank you for, you know, letting me talk about this. And, you know, I hope it does, you know, cause some discussion and some awareness. And, you know, I'd love to hear from anyone who has, you know, any questions or wants to talk about anything further.
Your website is authorkatherinegrant.com, is that correct?
That's correct, yep.
I linked it to the webpage, Mike.
Oh, okay. Thanks, Matt. Last and maybe the most important question is, do you get the Superman joke a lot? You know, Cat Grant.
You know what? The funny thing is that Chris Golden, I saw him last night, and he made that joke too.
Oh, he did. Did he?
Yes, he did.
Yeah. So, well, yeah. Thank you very much for being on the show, Catherine. I really appreciate it, and really. Appreciate hearing what you had to say on this.
All right, thank you so much for having me, Mike, and it was great to be, you know, to be involved with this.
Well, thank you. And when the audio podcast edition is available, I'll email that to you as well. So, yeah, all you got to do is close your browser, and then it'll kick you out. So,
all right, thank you, Mike.
So thanks again, Catherine.
Nice thanks, you. Catherine.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay, so Kelly Young was not on the podcast last night. Apparently he had something more important to do.
Hang out with your cock out. I was at the Def Leppard concert, you guys, so pour some sugar on that.
No, we don't want to see when you had sugar poured on you. Thank you very kindly.
So, one of the things I thought we could talk about, well, first of all, let's talk about Reanimators is available to order.
Reanimators has been available for a long time.
Reanimatrix, I'm sorry. Yeah. Reanimatrix is available to order.
Now, one thing, if you look it up, for some strange reason, all his other books, all of Pete's books are by Peter Rolick, and this is by Pete Rolick. So if you do a search on Amazon for Peter Rolick, it doesn't pop up in a nice place.
Yeah. Search for Reanimatrix.
You do a search on Reanimatrix to find it.
That's weird because they all say Pete Rolick on my – but, yeah, it happens. It's weird.
Well, this is the third book in the trilogy?
This is the third book in my ongoing series. I'm not
is
sure.
It's like the Douglas Adams thing where you're going to have like the fifth book in the trilogy and that kind of thing.
Yeah, well.
The yes. Increasingly ill-named Reanimators trilogy.
Yes, yes. Reanimatrix wraps up some loose ends from Reanimators and then creates whole new ones, which I didn't realize I had done until like 3 months ago. And it's like, oh, wait, I didn't resolve that plot point. So
yeah,
now
there's a lot of sex in the. Most importantly, there's a lot of sex in the book. So
yeah, there's some sex in the
book. Yeah, not, there's some. I'm joking when I say a lot. Reanimatrix is available in print and Kindle from Nightshade Books by Pete Rolick. An obsessed detective on the trail of a murdered young woman finds more than he bargained for. In this tale of hard-boiled cosmic horror, an inventive mashup of the pulp detective detective story and Lovecraftian terror. And you got some great editorial quotes down here from Wendy Wagner, Orrin Gray. Publishers Weekly says, Rolick takes readers on a kaleidoscopic terror ride. Lovecraft connoisseurs will find much to love in this frequently gruesome and at times quite racy tale. So, you know, everybody listen to this, check it out.
Yeah. And
yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
You know, I like it. Well, I like it. I wrote it, you know.
Better like it.
I better like it. I did a lot of work on this. It's a fun book. Half the book is told from Robert Peasley's point of view. The other half is told from Megan Halsey's point of view. It's dedicated to three people who I thought are really important to my writing style. Willem, Bob, and Joe. And I really do appreciate everything that they've done in the past, not only guide me in my writing, but also to help me out and find a publisher. So, yeah, it's a good book. I like it.
Hey, Pete, will there be somebody carrying these at the film festival?
Funny, you should ask. According to FedEx, a crate of 24 copies will be delivered to my hotel on Wednesday.
Perfect.
Whether I get there or not is another question.
Put me down for one of those.
Oh, you don't know for sure if you're going, though?
I have tickets. I have a hotel room. I'm ready to go. Hurricane Michael is a little close.
Oh, yeah,
Matthew,
right.
Don't take my name in vain, buddy.
I'm sorry. Matthew is a little close. I'm right outside the zone of impact, but the storm is very large. And if we have severe winds, my plane won't take off.
Oh, right. Yeah, because you've got more to deal with than just whether you get hit or not.
Right.
Is the film festival this coming Sunday?
Yes. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Why is it coming up that quick?
Yeah.
And the hurricane's still, a day away from Jamaica and stuff, right?
Right. It's supposed to. Yeah, it's supposed to be Wednesday, Thursday. So.
Mm.
I'm uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Well,
I hope that doesn't happen. Is this supposed to affect the weather in the whole country? I mean, obviously not hurricanes.
Not the whole country. It looks like it's going to shoot straight up the coast. Do its thing all the way from Florida to North Carolina. Maybe even further.
I didn't know if you've read anything like it's supposed to push the country into fall temperatures or anything like that, or if it's just the coast.
No, I think it's just the coast.
Keep dreaming, Mike.
That's exactly what I'm doing. Exactly what I'm doing. Okay, so Reanimatrix, you might be able to pick it up if you're going to the H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival in Portland.
Yep.
And regardless, you can get it on Amazon. And
yes.
Are they delivering the Kindle versions right now, or is that...
No, oddly enough, the Kindles are holding steady on being the release on October 4th, which is 2 days from now.
Okay.
It's weird.
All right, well, that's coming right up, though.
Yeah. So. I don't understand how any of that works.
Yeah, I'm a publisher, and I don't either, so...
It's so... You know, the funny thing is, I don't even have a copy right now. So, I have to go to Portland to get a copy.
Well, okay, so Reanimatrix, and then Swift to Chase is coming right up, too. I don't know. I don't have it in front of me. Is it the 7th of October, something like that?
But I'd already seen, as of yesterday, I already saw two or three people who were showing Facebook pictures of their copies, and a week ago, I'd seen some people holding it up, but they were ARCs, and these weren't ARCs. So,
it looks like.
Yeah, I think, wasn't Amazon supposed to release it like Thursday or something?
Hey, I'm looking it up right now. What, Matt?
I haven't got my copy yet.
It comes out on, it doesn't have a date. It just says not yet released. But I'm pretty sure that Chris Payne said the 7th. Anyway, it's coming right up within the next week. I just want to make people aware of it. Swift to Chase by Laird Barron, latest collection of short stories. Laird Barron's fourth collection gathers a dozen stories set against the backdrops of the Alaskan wilderness, far future dystopias, and gallow-fueled nightmare vistas. Anyway, I've read some of this already, and it's obviously, it's Laird Barron, so it's really good. So
good-looking cover.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So check that out. And then this isn't till like March, I think, The Night Ocean. Now, we had this guy on a few months back, Paul Lafarge. And the reason being is because I love that Lovecraft short story. Actually, it's more Barlow short story, The Night Ocean. And, you know, this has to do with that short story. Basically about a guy, well, Marina Willett has a problem. Her husband, Charlie, has become obsessed with the horror writer H.P. Lovecraft, in particular with one episode in Lovecraft's life in the summer of 34. The old gent lived in 2 months with a young fan named Robert Barlow. What were they up to? Were they friends or more? Just when Charlie thinks he solved the puzzle, a scandal erupts and he disappears. The police say it's suicide, but Marina does not believe them. And then she follows her husband's trail in an attempt to learn the truth. You know, I'm like 50 pages into this, and I'm not the world's biggest fan of stories that feature Lovecraft as a character, even a minor character. I'm just not. But, man, is this good. So, unless it takes a sharp right turn and goes down, which I doubt, it's really, really good, and I recommend people buy it when it comes out. It's got some great editorial reviews from, well, reviews from several people. Victor LaVale says it's brilliant.
Okay, Mike.
Lev Grossman,
available the magician. March, right? So you got the nail copy?
Sorry, what?
This isn't available till next March, is my understanding, right?
Right.
You got an advanced copy?
Yeah. Lev Grossman read it too. The Magician's Trilogy? I know who Lev Grossman is, but. So these are a bunch of people saying it's great. Yeah, it's an advanced review copy. Arrived in the mail the other day, and.
You should have an arc of something else that's due on Halloween that you got last week too.
I am. I do.
Yeah. Dennis didn't send you an arc? A Caligari? Oh, yeah.
Well, you know he did. I posted a picture of it in the blog post a couple weeks ago.
Well, I'm just saying. I don't even have an arc. I'm like Pete. I don't even have a copy of the book.
Well, some people get arcs and some people don't. And some people have fooled other people into thinking they're important enough to get arcs. And that's me. Mm. So, yes, here it is. The Madness of Dr. Caligari. So there's some good books coming up in weird fiction.
And I will just, again, because if you've never seen the movie and you're interested in this book, it's streaming on Netflix with a wonderful, clear print that was made by, obviously, by people who love the movie, printed from the original negative with some things to clean up some areas that were not so clean. It's a beautiful print. And you can watch it on Netflix. And you'll have just, because this is coming out in a couple days, you can get it watched in a couple weeks, then you'll really enjoy the book more.
Yeah, it is coming out in a couple days. When is the exact release date, Joe?
October 30th.
October 30th. Oh, right, yeah, day before Halloween.
Yep.
Great cover, too, by the way.
Thanks, yeah. Harry O. Morris.
Oh, yeah.
And Nick Gucker and Papers. And I haven't seen inside the book. I don't know how the end papers look. The artwork looked great. The title cards, I'm dying to see how they look on the page.
Talking about this? Right here?
No. It's supposed to have other end papers as well as that. Maybe just the hardcover.
Not mine. No. But if it's Nick Gucker, I'm sure it's great.
Oh, it's phenomenal. How do the title cards look?
There you go.
Great. Every story title we made up a Caligari title card for, so.
Nice.
That looks.
Yeah, it really is a beautiful book.
Yeah, Michael Waltz did a great job building the book. Really did.
So, Yeah, which brings up, talking to the audience now, Fedogen and Bremer, you know what? Dennis, he gives away free books to my audience, and he's published in The Madness of Dr. Caligari, and, you know, Google Fedogen and Bremer, and if you like Lovecraftian fiction, which I assume you do if you're listening to us yak every week, and weird fiction, these are just beautiful, beautiful books built to last. So, yeah, he's not paying me to say that, but just check out that site. Those are beautiful books, and he's got quite a catalog. So,
yeah, I'd go as far as to say, is there the successor to Arkham House?
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.
All right, since Young wasn't here last night, apparently a concert's more important.
It's a Def Leppard concert, you guys.
Like, whatever, dude. You know, I was editing, first of all, the audio podcast of the Halloween show is available on iTunes and elsewhere already. So if you want to listen to that on the go on your commute this week, you can do that. But while I was editing that this morning, I thought the whole thing was interesting, but one of the really interesting parts to me was, and fun parts, was when we were talking about movies. And, you know, I thought we could have talked about that even more. And I wanted to, since it's October the 2nd and Halloween is coming up and it's autumn, I wanted to touch on a couple of movies that bring out autumn and Halloween to me, and that I'll be watching this month again, as time allows. And I thought you guys might want to do the same, especially you, Kelly, since you weren't here last night. Let me go through a couple, and then why don't you shout out a couple, Kelly?
Sure.
One that didn't get mentioned last night, one of my favorites, is What Lies Beneath, with Harrison Ford and Michelle Pfeiffer. I mean, that's just a real, I don't know. I love that movie. It's a really, really good movie. I think I've watched it 5 or 6 times. We mentioned The Fog and Trick or Treat. This is not a horror movie, but Autumn feel. Good Will Hunting is a movie with a good autumn feel to it, at least in my opinion. We mentioned The Others. We didn't mention Salem's Lot, you know, the 1979 one. I love that movie. We did mention The Changeling. A couple others we did not mention that are my favorites are Clue. And I know it's a comedy, but still.
Good movie, though.
Yeah. Lady in White. The Woman in Black. Stir of Echoes. I love those as well.
Oh, really? No, did nobody bring up Something Wicked This Way Comes?
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, that was brought up.
We talked about that more than any of the other movies last night.
All right.
That's good, because that would be probably the first one I'd drop in for a regular viewing around Halloween.
Oh, yeah. And I love that Matt mentioned the first words in that movie. Matt, I forget the exact quote. What was it again?
It's part of the first words. It's like, the air smells like smoke.
Oh, yeah. It was October and the air smelled like smoke, something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. What the hell is your mute button on for? You're supposed to be listening to movies.
Oh, am I supposed to be talking? Boy, yeah. I forgot always how much I liked Stir of Echoes. That is a great film. For me, Halloween 3 is my favorite in the Halloween movies. I think that the first Halloween is a masterpiece. Obviously, it was such an influence on everything that came afterwards. But I loved that Carpenter's original idea was to put out a Halloween movie every year that would be completely different. It was not going to be a series of Michael Myers stuff. And I really, really love Halloween 3.
I get to see that on the big screen on the 13th.
Oh, nice. See, Season of the Witch is a movie I think that could really be remade and had some justice done to it, although the original still stands up very well for me.
I've not seen, before you go on to the next movie, I've not seen Halloween 3 yet, and something I've heard about it is that when it first came out, it was reviled, and now it's revered. Is that true, and why is that?
I don't know if it's revered yet. Everyone I talk to hates it.
Really?
It was reviled because it had no connection to the previous two Halloween movies. But right. I have a DVD of it, and I think it's a great movie.
Yeah, I love that one. And if we're going to talk Carpenter, I'll watch In the Mouth of Madness sometime this month, and probably Cigarette Burns, his episode from Masters of Horror.
The Fog.
Yeah, The Fog's a great one. Other than that, I'm not sure. You know, I'm sure with all of you guys, horror is just a part of our life. So when Halloween comes around, it's not like it's that much different than any other time of the year for me, except for the weather change, which is something I'm really looking forward to.
Yeah. Yeah, and we watch a lot of horror, like you said, all year round. I'm trying to recommend some to the audience that are our favorites and that evoke that this time of the year for us.
Something that I watched just recently and I forgot how good it was Christopher Walken in Stephen King's Dead Zone film. I thought that was just amazing, and I forgot that I thought that was amazing. Mm-hmm. And if we're talking King, I love Cycle of the Werewolf, the Silver Bullet film.
Yeah.
So back when Busey wasn't as crazy as he is now, but that's one that really holds up well, I think. The werewolf design on that is fantastic.
It scared the hell out of me when I watched it as a kid and on a vacation at my uncle's in Texas.
Yeah.
For little kids, you know, because I've got little kids, Corpse Bride, Hocus Pocus, the Halloween Town series, which, you know, they're a little hokey, but, you know.
Yeah, Logan liked them. And I thought, they really got that Halloween Town, but yeah, he liked it.
And then I caught this one last year, Girl versus Monster. It was like a pilot for a series that just never took off. Kind of her parents are steampunk ghost hunters. And one night before the Halloween festival, their ghost chamber breaks through and everything they've captured gets loose. And she has to go collect everything. Not great. But, you know, sort of like a proto-Buffy thing for little kids.
So you like Stir of Echoes a lot, Kelly?
Yeah, but I'm a huge Matheson fan, as you know.
Yeah.
If we're talking about movies for little kids, Abbott and Costello meets Frankenstein.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Which was the best, ironically, was the best mixture of the monsters movies that Universal ever made.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All the other ones have flaws in them. They don't give enough attention to the monster, or Frankenstein meets the Wolfman, Lugosi blew it as the monster or whatever. Here, everybody's perfect as the monsters. The comedy works. The horror works. It's just incredible.
Yeah. I might even throw in Monster Squad for something like Halloween viewing. That was one that I think that's corny as hell, but I still really love it.
I like Monster Squad too.
One of the things that it's not autumnal, but because it's my introduction to horror, is Frankenstein. And I can't watch Frankenstein without watching Bride. So.
And then you can't watch both of those without following it with Young Frankenstein, in my opinion.
Which has got great knockers. So how can you not watch?
I knew that somebody was going to go there.
Well, thank you.
Have you seen a movie called Spirit of the Beehive?
No.
Got me there, Rick.
Oh. It's a very award-winning film in Europe, and it's a story about a young girl in, it's not really a true horror movie, but it's a young girl in Spain right after the Civil War who sees Frankenstein for the first time in a cinema.
What is that movie, Rick?
Spirit of the Beehive.
Hmm.
It's more along the levels of Val Lewton's Curse of the Cat People.
Hmm.
I would say, it's more of about childhood fantasies that she fantasizes meeting a monster.
See, Frankenstein is so huge for me. I think I was 8 when I read the classic illustrated comic book. And, you know, 11, I believe, when I read Shelley. And, of course, saw the movie after the comic.
I gotta throw in, for some reason, Hammer films really feel autumnal to me, even though that's not ever a thing that they try for, I think. But Captain Kronos, Vampire Hunter, man, that one I can watch over and over, but for some reason, it'll always end up in my Halloween viewing.
Yeah, it's the best way to describe it is it was done by Brian Clemens, who did the Avengers, not the Marvel Avengers, the John Steed Emma Peel.
Right.
And basically, it's sort of the Avengers meet vampire movies.
Yeah, it's really something else.
It's got great sword fights.
Yeah.
It's some very cool, it's very serious in some ways. But there's a nice little tongue-in-cheek atmosphere to it. And it stands all the cliches of the vampire movies on their head.
Yeah.
In that there are many species of vampires, and they don't necessarily have the same attributes. And they have to, the vampire hunter has to figure out how the vampires work. You know, what are their weaknesses? When do they function? You get a sympathetic hunchback, which I liked.
Hmm.
And it's got Caroline Monroe in it, so
right.
You can't ask for anything more.
Yeah, and that one probably not just a good Halloween viewing, but it probably stands up as my favorite Hammer film of all.
I guess for me, for Halloween viewing, I'll probably watch Bela Lugosi's Dracula. That.
See, I would rather watch The Mexican.
The Spanish version, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you guys like the Frank Langella one? Langella?
I love parts of it.
Yeah, parts of it. It's okay. It's kind of like the, what was the over top one with Gary Oldman? Was it Francis Ford Coppola? Was that it?
Coppola's, yeah.
Just Dracula, yeah.
Like, there are parts of that I like, but.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard for me to watch it because it's so long, but the first Donnie Darko movie.
Oh, I love Donnie Darko.
Really good for setting that sort of Halloween feel to it.
Yeah.
The Spanish version of Dracula, which was the Universal, before they had, you could dub movies.
Right.
They would remake the whole movie with a different cast.
Yeah, they were filming the Spanish version at night. The American cast would leave, and then everybody'd come in, and they were remaking the same movie with an entirely different cast in a different language.
And a much stronger film, in my opinion.
Oh, unbelievable! When you have you ever A-B'd them back to back?
I haven't.
Oh. It's something you got to do once.
I can barely watch the original. Todd Browning was such a drunk. Most of the directing was done by his director of photography. And you can see long shots with cardboard in the background leaning against sets.
But when you actually A-B them in a single setting, it's unbelievable the talent that's in the Spanish version as opposed to what we get in the, you know, English version. There's no reason to ever watch the English version again.
Yeah.
And you also have an extra scene in the Spanish version. which tells you what happened to Lucy Westerner after she became a vampire.
Another thing in the Spanish version that becomes very apparent real early on is camera angles and whatnot. The American version, I would argue, is just blah. It's like you stick the camera there and turn it on. Wow. Whereas the Spanish version is like takes into account things like expressionism and art history, and you know, it's like this camera is capable of things other than just standing there static.
I can comment. I'd read what they did was they would come in and watch the dailies from the English language version,
mm-hmm.
use that information to choose their camera angles, so that they had the advantage of you had this already had a dry run. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
This is all colored by my childhood experience in Bela Lugosi. And it's like.
Sure, but keep in mind, I wasn't joking. Browning was a huge drunk and was drunk most of the time he was shooting that. His director of photography was left to do those shots, and many times the camera was just set up, the focus was pulled, and they were left to do the shot. So that's why you get those scenes that are not very energetic, and that's why in a couple of those scenes you get a medium shot of two people talking and no cuts. And in particular, in one of those scenes, you can see a piece of cardboard leaning against the back wall of the set because nobody bothered to move it before the shot was taken.
In the Spanish version, when you see Dracula at the top of the stairs and his descent, that's just an amazing piece of cinema. When you think about what year that was shot in and what had come before it and whatnot, it's absolutely revelatory as to what it's going to, you know, the ripple effect from that is going to go through the rest of horror cinema.
Kelly,
go ahead, Mike.
I was just going to say it. You're a special snowflake.
Aren't we all?
Well, yeah, but you're labeled.
I just wanted everyone to know.
For those listening later, the label on the screen when Kelly talks is Kelly Young Special Snowflake. And it's true. True. Have you guys seen Ash versus the Evil Dead?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, my God, that's awesome.
It will be
premiering
tonight on cable television.
Oh, is tonight the new season? Excellent.
Yeah, there was a site, an internet site, which was giving you a preview of it, so I've already seen the first episode of the second season.
This is a TV show now?
Yes.
Yes.
You know what? One of the things I really like about the show, and I noticed this again in the first episode of the second season, is it is a horror comedy. It's not just a comedy. And there are some really atmospheric, moody shots. You guys, have you noticed that? Especially Kelly, you're in the business. When they go to visit Kelly's parents and, you know, the wind blowing the windmill around, and they do a really good job of that.
Yeah, well, they're trying to emulate Raimi's style from back then, and you know, he had zero money, so all he had going for him was that he was willing to experiment, and that made for some really interesting visuals.
Now, is that Bruce whatever guy in this?
Yeah, Bruce Campbell.
Bruce whatever. Get off the podcast, you asshole.
He doesn't read the Lovecraft eZine blog, or he'd know that I interviewed Bruce Campbell last year about it. So
I don't remember. Bruce Campbell, you know, Kat's a big fan. I don't see what everybody sees there.
He's funny, but what was really funny was I think it was Sam Raimi, not him, but I says to him, I go, so were you a big Lovecraft fan growing up? And he's like, He goes, I didn't give a rat's ass about Lovecraft.
I got fucking Hawaiian shirts in the wardrobe. I mean, if I can wear a Hawaiian shirt.
Yeah, but can you say groovy like Bruce Campbell can?
Yeah, I can say groovy. I said groovy before he did. I'm older than he is.
Rick and Pete, you haven't seen this yet, right? Or Matt?
No, it's in the queue.
But... Okay, Rick and Kelly, am I right or am I wrong? Is this not a phenomenal TV show?
Yeah, it's phenomenal. We should also point out it has Lucy Lawless in it, too.
Yes. Yeah, it's an absolute blast. It's hysterical.
Well, is she at least dressed in her Xena outfit?
She is not. No, sexist.
But she has, you know, she has somehow gotten more beautiful as she's gotten older.
Yeah, one of the quotes from the first episode is Bruce Ash going to himself. Were you supposed to? Lucy Lawless is asking for help on something. I won't give it away beyond that. And he goes, should I save her because it's the right thing to do or because she's hot?
Well, that's a dumb question.
Which is just Ash Williams all the way, you know.
Right.
Does he got that chainsaw on his hands?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, hell yeah.
That's like the stupidest thing I ever saw.
Oh,
no, you can go. You can go.
Your generation gap is showing, Joe.
Well, this is the trailer for season two was banned at Comic-Con because the scenes with the chainsaw are pretty bloody. Yes. But in a fun, entertaining way.
Yeah, I cannot recommend it highly enough, and I'm very gratified again by the fact that it's not just a comedy. It's not just, you know, the gruesomeness that you'd expect, but it does have those moody, atmospheric shots. I just love the whole thing, and I really highly recommend it. I don't have TV, and I like it so much that on Amazon, I added the Stars channel for whatever it is, $7 a month or whatever, just for Ash versus the Evil Dead.
Nice.
See, Joe thinks that the chainsaw in the hand is really, really bad, but you know, frankly, the Uzi on the leg in Planet of Terror is much better.
Hey, Mike, before we go, I just want to show everybody or talk about a couple months ago you had Chuck Yeager and Matt Leacock on who did Pandemic and were doing the Pandemic Reign of Cthulhu game, and I ordered it during that show and it came, and it is really a gorgeous little game. I haven't had a chance to play it or really even unbox it until just now, but everything on it looks beautiful. It's really solidly put together. The game board is a very thick cardboard, and it comes with several cultist figures, Shoggoth figures, and then it looks like six or eight investigator figures, and then dice and some cards and everything. I'm really looking forward to jumping in and playing this game.
Where did you order it, or is the best thing to do just Google Pandemic Reign of Cthulhu?
Probably. I remember that
those who didn't see that show.
Yeah, Matt put up the link during the show, and I just went on and pre-ordered it. And it was, if everybody remembers, it was a really inexpensive game. You know, this is one of those gigantic games like Arkham Horror or Elder Sign, and it's priced at a much, much smaller price point, cheaper.
It's on sale at Amazon for like $35.
Yeah, jump on that, you guys.
Okay. Okay. Nice guys, too.
Yeah, I mean, they were.
They're not suffering from the we're way more talented than you, you know, syndrome. They were just pleasant to talk with and great guys.
Yeah, and I actually contacted the guy after that, and I don't know, it's sitting back there. I can't reach it. He had been talking about another Cthulhu game, I believe it was called, something else Cthulhu that he had kickstarted, and I missed it, but I contacted him personally and was able to order a copy of that too. So
okay.
Cool stuff.
So anyway, happy October, everybody. The podcast version of the Halloween show is already available. Just go to iTunes if you've got iTunes and search for Lovecraft eZine Podcast, or, you know, I link there. Just click on podcasts at the Lovecraft eZine website. It's got the links there. And this, today's episode, I'll put on probably Wednesday or Thursday if you're watching now and, you know, you want to listen to it on the go later. You only caught a bit of it. Whatever. So did we...
mention the prizes again?
Mention the prizes again. Exactly what I was going to say. We have this very fine key.
Where did that come from?
Yeah, I want one of those.
Me too.
That came from the guys who did... what's his name? The guy that... He's the actor that was in the Buffy episode. He played one of those guys. He plays a lot of monsters. He was in Guillermo del Toro's movie Plans Labyrinth. Oh, the guy, sure, with the eyes on his hand. Doug Jones,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Doug Jones. Well, they did I'm blanking on the photographer name right now. I know him and I should know it. And
Hoffine?
Yes, Joshua Hoffine. Thank you, Matt. He did a photographic portrait of Doug Jones not playing the monster, but, you know, in Innsmouth, playing the protagonist in Innsmouth with the fish creatures or whatever. Not fish creatures, the
deep ones.
Deep ones, yes. Thank you. Man, it's been a long day. Around him. It was great. It was great. And he gave me this and a couple of other things as a thank you for all the I spread the word about the Kickstarter quite a bit for him.
Yeah, I got in on that Kickstarter. I'm really looking forward to getting that book. Man, that is a really cool thing. So that's like a little one-of-a-kind prop.
Yeah.
It is. It is a very, very cool prize. I mean, maybe one of the coolest I've given out on the show. And it's just been sitting around, and I thought, I'm not the collector that a lot of people are. Someone is going to get a hell of a lot more joy out of this than I am. And I do appreciate those guys sending it to me. I'm just saying that I think it would, for someone who's really a collector that really enjoys this kind of stuff, will probably enjoy it even more than I have. It's in great shape. If you're listening later and can't see it, it's a metal, old-fashioned metal key with a leather tag on it that says Gilman House, Innsmouth, Massachusetts, room 428.
Yeah, you know what's really cool
about this is he probably had it in his pocket. He played the character. So it probably never even appeared in the photograph, but it added, what do you want to call it? Added realism.
Verisimilitude.
And it was like just part of the overall ambiance of the photograph to get into the mood. You know what I mean?
That's a good point. It's great. So I'm giving that away, and two Kindle copies of Nightmare's Disciple by Joe Pulver. So if you'd like to get in on those prizes in between any time this week, which means any time between now and through next Sunday, I'm making a slight change. I'm going to draw the prizes on Monday mornings for the 8 days before, so which gives people through the following Sunday. So in other words, this is October the 2nd. You have through the Sunday of October the 9th of 2016 to get in on this. So just send an email to lovecrafteasingprizes@gmail.com. That's all one word, lovecrafteasingprizes@gmail.com. If you want Nightmare's Disciple, put that in the subject. If you want the key, just put Innsmouth key in the subject of the email. Write whatever you want in the body of the email. And I use random.org to choose the winners from those who email in. So
nice. Can I mention one more thing, Mike?
Yeah, please do.
So Rick Tillman, editor-in-chief of Strange Eons, tells me that Strange Eons issue 20 will be available tonight online. It's got stories by Kurt Favre, Clint Hale, Christopher Slatsky, alternate covers, both by John Donald Carlucci, and it even comes with this super cool print from Rob Corliss. And it's got comics and interviews and reviews and all that stuff in it, and that's available.
When you order, do you get a choice as to which you choose the cover, or is it
random?
You can choose
the cover. It is not random. You have a choice of what cover you want.
Cool.
And it's strange-eons with an AEONS.com, correct?
Yes, it is. Thank you.
So yeah. All right. Thanks. Anything else we need to cover before we're done?
Well, I want to thank you for giving me the cover for the Lovecraft eZine.
Yeah. That cover.
Think Carpenter.
Cover art is gorgeous, too. Yeah.
Think Carpenter and Kreitner. They're the ones that did the actual work on this issue. So.
That gave me three covers for October that I really loved. And I'm going to have to put out some money for artwork.
Yeah, speaking of which, Lovecraft eZine 38 is out at the website. And, yeah, we get a lot of visits, but we always appreciate comments. The more popular Facebook gets, the less comments I see on actual websites, it seems. So it's free to read. If you want the Kindle, Pete's got a story in it. Doug Wynn's got a story in it. Several other people. Mike Griffin, yes. If you do want the Kindle or print version, those will be available this coming week. I'm a little behind, but those will be available real quick. They're actually almost done. And last but not least, last thing I want to say is that I really appreciate, there's been some people lately who have written in to say how much they enjoy the podcast. And that means a lot to me because you never know who's listening. The latest email I received, and I'm not going to name any names for obvious reasons after you hear me read it, but I really appreciate this. He says, you and the eZine show, the podcast, has helped me a lot in the past. I've been struggling with depression for years now, and hearing you guys talk all things Lovecraftian almost every week has helped me survive some of my lowest moments. So keep up the good work. You do good in more than one way. So I wanted to read that especially to you guys and also to think the audience members that email in and tell me how much you like the show.
That's so nice.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah.
Yeah. If you have ideas for the show or want to make a comment, lovecrafteasing@gmail.com. So, and then the prizes address is lovecrafteasingprizes@gmail.com. So thanks for listening. And next week we've got Richard Cox, the author of The Boys of Summer.
Oh, cool. So,
see you next week.